Forget.
I'm such a horrible leader.
Worship your holy name. Man, I love that song. Good morning. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning, here in person and online. We are so glad to lift our voices to the Lord together. A couple of things I want to point out to you in your bulletin, if you have one. There's the card in there. I know you've seen it 100 times, but it does a few things. One, is if you have a prayer request that you'd like the elders to pray over, or a praise that you'd like to share with them, you can put that on here and drop it in the box as you're on your way out. But the other thing is, on the other side, if you're new or a visitor and you'd like to learn more about Mountain Christian Church, you can fill this out. Also, there's a line on the very bottom that says, I'd like to be, actually, I'll just tell you what it says. I'd like to receive the MCC newsletter. Every Friday, we mail out, we email a newsletter. It's called The Link, and it talks about all the stuff going on at church, has our blog every week, has those kind of things. If you'd like to be on that, fill that out, drop it in, and we'll put you on it and share all the information there is to have. In your bulletin today, there's a few things I'd like to point out. One is there's a prayer request section right here in the middle. And this week, it has a prayer request from Pastor Tesfaye in Ethiopia. Anyway, he's one of the missionaries that we support through missions. And anyway, he's got some good stuff there. Please make sure you see that. Photos in the directory. I don't know how often it happens, but somebody, I'm talking to somebody about ministry or something they're trying to do, and I say, hey, you know, Peter Feldner is somebody you should probably get a hold of. He could be very helpful in doing that. And they're like, oh, okay, they're in the directory. And they'll look in the directory, and if he is, everything's great. And if not, I get a call 5 minutes later. How do I get a hold of Peter? So we are updating the directory. We're supposed to be doing photos today, but due to some health issues in the family of the photographer, we're not going to do it today. We're postponing it for a few weeks. So keep your eyes open for that. The photo directory has two purposes. One is to have your face in there if you're willing to do that. And if you look and you see Pete's face in there, he's got a smile on it. It's huge. But if you're not comfortable having your picture in there, then get your contact information in there, right? That way people can get a hold of you for whatever reason they're looking for. We won't give out that information to creditors, though, so you don't have to worry about that. A few other things that are happening. In 2 weeks, we're having our annual budget meeting here at the church after service. So if you're a member, please make sure to plan for that. There's an opportunity to help Shine at A. Montoya. They've got a garden project going, and they'd like to get some people involved. And then, of course, there's Bible studies and those things. Check this out. There's lots of information in there, and we'd like to get you involved however we can. All right, let's pray, and we'll continue in worship. Father God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for giving us opportunity, Lord, to worship together. And, Lord, I just pray that as we lift our voices, that, Lord, you would be honored and glorified, and that our hearts would be open to what you would have us to learn today. Lord, bless us and keep us. Be well. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you'd stand with us. Here we go. If you'd stand with us again, please.
I was just lost.
Lord, we lay everything down at your feet right now. We brought in a lot of junk from this week, Father God. I just pray that you'll wash it away, that you'll fill us with your spirit, your words, your mercy, and your eyes, Lord, for others. Amen.
Praise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is. I raise a hallelujah. still there is a healer. His love is deeper than the sea. His mercy is unfailing. His arms are fortress for the weak. Let faith arise. Let faith arise. I lift my hands to thee again. You are my refuge. You are my strength. As I pour out my heart, these things I remember. You are faithful God.
Give us everything.
Thank you.
you're the tower we run to when the rest of the world has gone nuts, or even our own minds have gone nuts. Father God, you are constant, and you are always, always true. Thank you, Lord, for your love for us. Amen. You may be seated.
This morning for our communion devotion, I'd like to read from Philippians chapter 4. If you want to flip over there, we'll start in verse 4. For those of you who are here, we practice the Believer's Fellowship communion. So if you are not a regular attender here, but you know the Lord and you have a relationship with Him, then we invite you to share communion with us. But if you don't have a relationship, then we would ask that you would take this time to pray and ask the Lord to show you what you're missing. All right, Philippians 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Whatever we have seen or learned or heard from him, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with us. And that's why we do communion, is because he's told us to do it, right? Jesus has said, "This is my body broken for you. This is my blood poured out for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Well, and if you take it one step further, then the God of peace will be with you. This morning, as we come together to do communion, we're going to take a moment of silence before we do it. And I'd like to encourage you to take that minute to confess, to get rid of anything that might be between you and your Lord, so that he would be open to prayer and petition and to doing communion with us. So we'll have a moment of silence, and then I'll pray for us. All right? You bow with me? Father God, we come before you. And Lord, we just ask that you would accept our humble requests, that you would accept our humility. Lord, that you would forgive us for those things that we have failed. Lord, I ask that you would bless each and every one of us today. Lord, let this time of communion, Lord, continue to build our relationship with you. And Lord, that this would be one more step towards us worshiping you. We've worshiped you in song. We want to worship you in communion, and then we will worship you in word in a few moments. Lord, we just ask that you would be with us in all things, and that you would help us to focus on whatever is true and right and admirable and excellent. Lord, bless us today and throughout this week. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
through this sweet little letter, First Peter, that he writes to these that he loves. I want to start again this morning. We don't always do this by any means, but we did it last week, going to do it again today. If you would, with me, stand, and let's go ahead and read God's Word together. We're going to read the portion that we are going to be talking about today, and then we'll pray and continue from there. So you can grab your outline for notes. If you want to take notes, have those nearby, and hopefully you got your spot. 1 Peter chapter 3, starting in verse 1. In the same way, you wives, be submissive to your own husbands, so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word, they may be won without a word by the behavior of their wives, as they observe your chaste and respectful behavior. Your adornment must not be merely external, braiding the hair and wearing gold jewelry or putting on dresses. Let it be the hidden person of the heart, with the imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. For in this way, in former times, the holy women also who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, being submissive to their own husbands, just as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. And you have become her children if you do what is right without being frightened by any fear. Let's pray. Gracious God, there are portions of your scripture which Scripture itself says are hard to understand. There are portions of your Scripture that are not hard to understand, but we might be, at least at first blush, terrified to read. But Lord our God, we know you, the God who speaks, the giver of your word, the rescue of our souls, and the lover of our hearts. Father, we ask today, would you take from the sweetness of your word and give it to us, men and women together, as we gather here and others joining us online, Lord, and would you be glorified? Would you take from what is yours and make it ours? Would you do your work to continue to change us here today? Would you let your word go forth? Let its life give life. Let its rebuke kill sin. Let its nourishment feed our souls. Meet with us, for we are your people, and we ask you to be glorified here in our midst. In Christ's name, amen. Thanks, you guys can go ahead and take seats. We'll come to this passage this morning as we work our way through 1 Peter, and I have really only one goal for our time together in this passage, and that is that if you despise this message, it would not be because of me. Actually, that's not really true. I actually just said that to try and be funny, and it didn't work. In reality, I have a far higher, a much richer, and a way more impossible goal and desire for our time together and for us here today. And it is that you would love this passage. And if you do, it will not be because of me, but it will be because of the excellencies of God as he reveals his goodness to us in this sweet passage of Scripture this morning. Peter at this point is encouraging these blood-bought, chosen exiles who are scattered throughout the lands, encouraging them to live lives of hopeful, holy witness before a world of unbelief. He has addressed at this point, as we saw coming to this point at the end of chapter 2, he has addressed our role under government authority. After that, he has addressed our relationships in servant and master situations. Now he comes to husband and wife, and he will go on from here. This morning with husbands and wives, I don't want to skim over either of these two callings because I think the biggest problem is to take a look at this issue or to take a look at these passages very superficially. It's when we spend time to listen to the words of our great God who gives them that we find the richness of them. So Lord willing, my goal is to just take the first of these two today and then take the other, Lord willing, next time. So today, Peter gives us first, in the passage that we read, the wife's radiant witness to her husband. The wife's radiant witness to her husband. Again, verse 1, in the same way you wives, be submissive to your own husbands, so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word, they may be won without a word by the behavior of their wives, as they observe your chaste and respectful behavior. Wife, then, what is the radiant witness to your husband? This passage says to submit to him. The passage is somewhat clear in that sense, but understanding the why and the how and the purpose are where the richness comes in. Let's excavate that command to submit to your own husband. Let's meditate on it, and let's be nourished by it, both women and men together here today. First, I just want to note in a cursory way that this exhorts the wife to submit to her husband. I think I said it a couple of weeks ago, but the scripture does not command women to submit to men or for a woman to submit to other husbands. She is only to submit to her husband. Let's notice several aspects then of this command. First, I want you to notice, I'm going to give you about 6 or 7, by the way, so if you're taking notes, you just get to fit them in. Good luck in this first section. First aspect of this command, notice that it is comprehensive. This command to submit to husband is comprehensive. In other words, it is for every wife because we find it inclusive of all husbands. Middle of one, be submissive to your own husband so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word. The word disobedient in 1 Peter is used 3 other times outside of this passage, and in every case it speaks of a non-believer. Disobedience to the word is that refusing and rejecting of the word of God. In fact, in chapter 4 or 5, I think it is specifically called disobedient to the gospel. So it is the one who is not a believer. There are women there scattered throughout the known world that Peter is aware of, that he is writing to as part of these churches, whom he knows their husbands are not followers of Christ. And so he says, even in this case, he includes unbelieving husbands. But notice that's not the only case in the passage, so that even if any of them are disobedient, meaning that in general, talking about all husbands, but even to the extent, wife, if your husband is not a believer. So I think then that it's comprehensive, it must also include believing husbands. And though the passage doesn't say it, I think it is not a stretch to say that includes believing husbands, whether they are having one of their good days or bad. The command then is for every wife, and it includes you if you're married. The command is comprehensive. Second, I want you to note that the command is voluntary. The command is voluntary. Now, don't confuse voluntary with optional. It is a command of the Lord, like other commands. But notice here that it is a command to the wife. Beginning of verse 1, be submissive to your own husband. That means it is not to be coerced. It is not a command given to husbands. You will search in vain in Scripture to find a place that will say, husbands, command your wife to submit to you. You won't find it because it doesn't exist. What you may find, in fact you will if you look hard enough, is a command to husbands to serve your wife as Christ served and died for the church. The point here is that this command to the wife is meant to be freely chosen. Any husband who forces his wife to submit will be answerable to God. This command, rightly understood, and I think you'll see, I hope you'll be convinced by the end of our time together this morning, you'll see that it is not meant just to force her to do something. It is meant to stir her heart, and then, once her heart is stirred, then to coerce her will in a spirit-led, God-honoring way. It's to make her say, yes, Lord, it is my joy to follow my husband and to do it, Lord, ultimately for your glory. Whether he fully understands, sees it, or rewards me, I know that you know. When she submits, it is because she chooses to. She is willing. It is wanted. It is worship. Paul happened to be going through Colossians and happened to hit a parallel passage here just a few weeks ago and said the same point. And I thought it was well noted that he did. There are parallels here within Peter of many different types of submission that Peter gives. And all of them are to be done willingly, and all of them to the glory of God. In fact, I think it's noteworthy and insightful to take a look at those different parallels. We'll do a bit of that here this morning, but one I just want to mention now. If you back up to 2:13 in that section, it speaks of our relationship with governing authorities. Listen to what it says in verse 16, because I think the same tenor is at work here with the wife and husband. It says, "Act as free men, and do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, but use it as bondslaves of God." So women, act as free men, or free women, you know what I mean? But not in a self-serving way, but rather use the freedoms that God has given you voluntarily as slaves to God. This command, first, is comprehensive. Second, it is voluntary. Third, it is consistent. It is consistent with all of the other places in Scripture, and particularly with these places right here in 1 Peter, where believers are called to submit. Notice the opening words in verse 1 of chapter 3, in the same way. In the same way as what, Peter? What are you referring to? Well, this is third in a list of commands and exhortations that are very much similar. Just as with the governing authorities, there's a relationship that is to be identified and appropriately honored, starting in 2:13. In the same way, there is a relationship that is to be identified and an authority appropriately to be submitted to with servants and masters, starting in 2:18. There are going to be more statements along these lines coming. The point is this: all believers are to honor the Lord with an appropriate submission. I hope we come away from our time in 1 Peter, and among so many other things, you think when you hear the word submission going forward, oh yeah, that's the thing that's commanded of wives in Scripture. No. There are so many statements about our appropriate submission in Scripture, just as Christ so well exampled for us. And it just happens that a wife with a husband is one of those. But all believers are to ultimately honor the Lord, because all submission is done as unto the Lord and done appropriately with His help. This then is a good place to say it this morning. Men, do you want your wife to be a joy and a pleasure to you? Well, then I would encourage you to be a man under authority. Because the command to be under authority is a command for every believer. If it is an effort to coerce, then you are out of bounds. Now, that's not the point of our passage today, so I won't spend a long time there. But in tracking the consistency, we need to see it within the broader picture. What you can do to serve your wife if you want her to be joyful is to demonstrate for her the humility and the submissiveness of your life, so that when she looks at you, she says, "Why would I not want to trust Him with mine? Why would I not want to give myself to Him?" Be a man under authority. So this command, we have noted, is comprehensive, voluntary, and thirdly, consistent. Consistent for all believers, just peculiarly addressed here for the wife of a husband. Fourth aspect of the wife's radiant witness to her husband, and we're now getting to the more radiant part. Fourth aspect is this command is intentional. This command is intentional. In other words, it is for a purpose. It's not random. It's not Scripture or God or some patriarchal movement saying, hey, let's just keep women down. No, look in the middle of 3:1. Be submissive to your own husbands, so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word, they may be won. The goal here is to win over. It's to persuade. It's to make attractive. In the case of the one, as Peter mentions, who is not a believer in the gospel, who doesn't yet know Christ, who doesn't take the Bible as anything worth any report or interest or time, they may be won, it says, by the behavior of their wives. Now, it requires a supernatural work of God. It takes a miracle to do that in a man's heart or a woman's heart for any of us to be saved. But Peter here is saying, this is a unique piece of my way of doing my work, my gospel work in the world. For a believer, then, I think there's still a winning over, but it's a winning back to the gospel. It's a winning back to the truth. So even if he's not obedient today, even if in this thing he might be foolish, there still is an opportunity. And I can attest to this winning over aspect in my own life, that it is intentional by God to get a husband's attention. When Molly and I were first married, right after our honeymoon, we moved to Dallas. So immediately you can understand the strain that we were under. When we were first married, we didn't have a lot of arguments. In fact, we don't even have a ton of arguments today. And that's not because we're just like so super spiritual or anything like that. Really, it's largely due to the fact that she came from a family where she just hates to argue and hates confrontation. And I come from a family where you win. And so what I figured out quickly is I could always win, and she would always let me win. And as soon as I won, it pretty quickly became clear to me that I lost. And not only did I lose, we both lost. And that happens every time somebody wins and somebody loses. Everybody loses. And so there was actually a period of time that I was freaked out. I didn't know what to do when a fight happened. I'm like, I'm going to totally mess this up. Anyway, we've worked our way through it, and we're still growing by the grace of God, and we still have a lot to learn. Well, in any case, we had had an argument at one point. And it was bad enough that we didn't solve it. The next morning, I came walking out of the bedroom, and she was sitting at our tiny little kitchen table in our not very big apartment. And I was a little guarded as I walked towards the kitchen, but it was clear that she wanted to talk, so I sat down. And she opened her mouth, and the first thing is she asked for my forgiveness. Now, I was pretty sure in my own estimation that I was somewhere between 80 and 100% responsible for this entire argument. But I sat down at the table, and she asked for my forgiveness. I don't think I need to tell you what happened in that moment. She didn't just win the argument. She won me. I was willing to do anything she wanted. And I thanked God for her, that she would be a woman to say, to whatever degree that I have sinned against you and sinned against God, I just want to make that right. And man, it got my attention, and I was won. Hers was a radiant witness to her husband. This command is intentional. Fifth, it's Christ imitating. This command is Christ imitating. Notice what it says here in the middle of one, be submissive to your own husband, so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word, they may be won without a word. What is Peter doing? Peter is having fun here. He's having fun with a word that is the word at this point. If they won't be won by a word, then have them won without a word, he says. Peter's play on words. What we need to catch here is that Peter has just mentioned Christ. That is the end of chapter 2. You saw it last week. He talked about Christ's example of suffering. And that's not just for what it comes on the heels of, which is the servant-master relationship. And it's not just as a lead-in to the wife-husband relationship. It is for all believers. And Peter will repeat it numerous times in this book. But it's poignantly put here in this place, in this section on submitting to authority, where Peter says, I get it. That may mean you sacrifice or you suffer at some level. Notice what he said of Christ earlier in chapter 2, verse 22. He said he didn't lie. No deceit was found in his mouth. 23, when reviled, he didn't revile. Later, he uttered no threats, but he kept entrusting himself to the Lord. 3-4 times in the passage, he speaks of Christ's silence and his faithfulness in chapter 2. So when he gets to this point, he says, wife, you have a Christ-imitating opportunity with your husband to be a radiant witness. When you can't argue him into the kingdom, maybe the point is to give up on arguments. When he won't listen to words, maybe it's the point beyond words where you just have to show him. Or maybe he's already a believer and he's acting foolishly and he will no longer listen to wisdom. At that point then, maybe you have to show him wisdom. And we, men and husbands, can be slow to learn. But for the grace of God helping us. Christ imitating without a word. Now, ladies, I'm going to say this caveat, and I'm going to say it only once because it's not at all the point of the passage, but it is a point of our context. This passage doesn't address times where you may need to speak up. But the passage doesn't say you can't speak, you can't have an argument, you can't have a discussion, you can't work towards a common understanding. But the hope at the end of it is to say, you know what, I think you've heard. I really do. I don't know if you agree. But at this point, the Lord has charged you to lead us. So I will follow you as you follow him. And that is a radiant witness to a husband that God can use in a peculiar way to get his attention if he is off base, or to bless him mightily when he does walk in the Lord's will, serving his wife as he should. But all along the way, it is the wife's desire to be Christ imitating. The worst case scenario where you actually have abuse or things like that are not addressed in this passage. Well, that's not true. I'll make a couple comments along those lines. Those are different sermons for another occasion. So don't think that Peter doesn't care, that I'm remiss in that. But to say those need to be addressed absolutely and fully. But 1 Peter 3 will not be the passage that gives us those directions. Here, our Christ imitating is, if he won't listen, maybe it's time to not try to shout him down. Maybe it's not time to try and emasculate him with words, or to attack him or offend, or in such a way to cut his knees out from under him, but instead to say, okay, you are charged to lead. I will follow. Another piece of this that is Christ imitating is what's found in verse 2. The middle of one says, they may be won without a word by the behavior of their wives as they observe your chaste and respectful behavior. The word chaste is the word pure. We don't use that word much today. It sounds a little dated, doesn't it? Chaste. It sounds a little Victorian, right? It sounds prudish. You know what? Honestly, maybe prudish isn't really bad, because prudish comes from the word prude, and that means wise. So maybe we need a little bit of prudishness. I need some prudishness in my life. So I won't apologize for the word, but if you'd like another word in common parlance, another translation of the Greek word there for chaste is pure. It's the same word that Paul will exhort of Timothy. He'll command Timothy to be pure in his discharge of his pastoral duties. In Titus 2, the older women are commanded to be pure and to teach the younger women to live such lives. The Apostle John in 1 John chapter 3 will use this same word of the Lord Jesus Christ himself, saying, just as he is pure, so we endeavor to be pure. What's the point here? It's a Christ likeness that the wife's radiant witness reveals to her husband. A pure life. Perfect? No way. There is no such person after the Lord Jesus. But a life marked by purity. In both of these phrases then, without a word and in pure behavior, Peter, inspired by the Spirit, is pointing to the Christ-imitating behavior that is a radiant witness to a husband. I'm so grateful for this body of Christ, because I've seen the marriages here, and so many of you women live a life marked by purity. So many of you husbands I have spoken with and can say, my wife is the greatest gift that God's ever given me. And rejoice in the gift that she is. Christ imitating is her radiant witness. Lastly, not only is it Christ imitating, it's also Christ honoring and Christ enjoying. It's also Christ honoring and Christ enjoying. Okay, great. Where do we see that? Verse 2. As they observe your pure and respectful behavior. Respectful, I don't think, is the best translation. This is the second of three times the exact same wording in the Greek. I'm going to disagree with just a bit. I'm not that smart. I read good commentaries. But as I do my work in the Greek and as I read their reasons, they are convincing to me. You can decide for yourself. Literally in the Greek, it says, as the husband, as they observe your pure and in fear behavior. Now, the NAS translators didn't like the thought of the wife being afraid of her husband. In fact, I think they were correct in that, because in a few more verses, we're going to read about them being fearless. That's my first reason for wanting a different translation. So what the NAS translators did is the word phobos, which is where we get phobia, where we get fear, it can be translated fear, but in other contexts it can be translated when between two people, it can be translated very appropriately respect. NAS uses respect here. Why? Because they're assuming that this is the wife's behavior in respect of her husband. But I don't think that's the way the passage is meant. So same thing I already said last week. It's not respect of the husband, it's fear of God. The behavior here is pure as unto the Lord. It's seeking to be pure as unto the Lord. And it is behavior acted out in fear of God. Great, Frank, where do you see that before? Well, I see that back in verse 18. Because in 2:18, he said, servants, be submissive to your masters with all respect. Literally, it says in fear. And I argued there that it meant in the fear of God, which will probably make you respect your master. But the keynote of all of it is all submission is done ultimately in loyalty unto the Lord. Well, great, Frank. So you changed two places in 1 Peter. Are you going to change some more? Yes, I am. I'm going to change the place in 1 Peter 3 where we're commanded to share the gospel and we're to live out our witness with respect. Except the word doesn't say with respect. It says in fear. So I think actually what Peter is encouraging us is to share the gospel in the fear of God. And chances are good, if you share the gospel with your friend in the fear of God, you'll probably be pretty respectful of that man or woman as a human being. Okay, great. So you're going to change three places. Why are you doing that? Well, just because of the verse that comes right before 2:18. And we'll look at it again. We looked at it last week, 2:17. Here's Peter's command. Honor all people. Love the brotherhood. Fear who? God. Fear God. Honor the king. He's the only one in the entire list that's commanded to be feared. And the very next verse says to fear. But it doesn't say who. So you think you can fill in the blank? I'm arguing to persuade you. Now, whether or not you end up in the same place, if you think it is phobos of the husband and you want to translate it respectful, great. I think godly commentators and translators, many do that. I don't happen to fall into their camp. I fall into the other. But here's the reason why. Because so many times in the passage, Peter makes the point, your loyalty towards your husband is not because of your husband at all. Your willingness to follow is not because of your husband. It's because of the Savior that you know. It is Christ honoring. And we could go further and say it's even Christ enjoying. Because Christ himself has modeled for us what it means to submit, man or woman, in whatever place. All of the wife's submission is a radiant witness to her husband because it's done unto the Lord and in his power. My deep desire, if you get nothing else for this morning, is that you get that one point. If you're a wife, there may be times you need to speak up. There may even be a time you need to disobey. We are clearly commanded to honor God first over our husband, over our government, over our masters or any other authorities when it comes to the point of sin. But within every submission that we do it ultimately unto the Lord. If you don't get that, then anything else you read in this passage really won't matter. If we do get that, then everything else in this passage really, for the most part, falls into place. Thomas Schreiner shares a quote, and he says it this way, "Wives do not submit in order to satisfy a husband's vanity or to promote his reputation. Neither do they submit to show how godly they are, nor to avoid conflict, nor to impress their neighbors, nor to manipulate their husbands, not even because she thinks she's wiser. She submits because of her relationship with and her trust in God." I think that is a radiant witness, and I've experienced it in my life, and many of you men and women have experienced it as well. Now, Peter goes on from here, and I think it gets even clearer. This focus upon the Lord and all that's done, it gets even richer and it gets even sweeter because he goes on now to give us the wife's enduring beauty in the sight of God. 3-6 is the wife's enduring beauty in the sight of God. Pick up verse 3. "Your adornment must not be merely external, braiding the hair, wearing gold jewelry, putting on dresses, but let it be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. For in this way in former times the holy women also who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, being submissive to their own husbands, just as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you have become her children if you do what is right without being frightened by any fear. Peter raises the issue of adornment or beautification at least three times in this very short passage. Here's the first thing you need to know about the adornment or the beauty here is that it is not external, it is internal, right? That's what he clearly says. So you go, okay, braiding hair, jewelry, dresses. Man, this is so difficult. So where do I get that Bible appendix that tells me which dresses I can wear and which one I can't, right? Here's what you need to know. The focus on this passage is not on what not to do. Okay, so which way can I pile up my hair on my head? And this way is sinful, but this way is God-honoring, right? Like, which is the right way to do this gig? The passage doesn't tell us because that's not the burden of the passage whatsoever. The burden of the passage is to say, there's a beauty. And man, you should pursue it with all your heart. But it's not a beauty that's seen immediately because it's not external. It's internal. I love Scripture for this, and I just affirm the wisdom of God that He does things like this so well. You know, the Scripture never commands you not to seek reward. You think, wait a minute, sure it does. No, go back to the passages that you think that, and almost every single time in writing, you'll find it's not a command not to seek reward. It's just that God looks at us and goes, you people are ridiculous. You seek all the wrong rewards. Let me tell you what is the real reward to seek. What is Peter doing here? What does the Spirit of God do in this passage? He doesn't come along and say, hey, don't seek to be beautiful. Don't seek not to adorn yourself. Let me tell you where real beauty lies. Let me tell you where real adornment lies. This is the wife's enduring beauty. Then there's that famous phrase that I know for some women, they almost cringe a little bit to hear because it feels so impossible. The middle of verse 4. It's a gentle and quiet spirit. And so many dear sisters, so many women say, you know, I was just born as a rambunctious person. And gentle and quiet just ain't what I do. It's just not who I am. It's a hard attitude. You can understand, or you can decide for yourself. You can determine for yourself. Maybe it is harder for certain personalities more than another. But I'll tell you what, I've met a couple of quiet personality women. I might even have one or two in my household, and they can be even more stubborn, okay? And I can be very quiet and very bitter and unsubmissive if I choose to. So this cuts through the personality differences, and it addresses the human heart. Gentle and quiet spirit. Let's talk about the beauty of this in the context in which it's given in Scripture. 1 Thessalonians 4, Paul will write to the believers there, and he will exhort this virtue, quietness. I'm looking at the word quiet now. Paul will exhort all believers to live a quiet life. He'll go on and say, don't be busybodies and gossips and tear down and destroy and make judgments about things you don't know. Live a quiet life. Work with your hands. Peter is going to say some very similar things in this passage. Boy, do we not live in a day that encourages us to be busybodies and have opinions about everything and fight tooth and nail to win arguments that really we're not even a part of. And so here with the wife, it's a little bit of an echo of winning without a word. But here he's not specifically talking about speech. He's talking about a lifestyle. He's talking about a quiet spirit. A woman may choose to be loud, and she may need to if there's a lot of children who need to hear her. But she can do it with a very quiet spirit at the exact same time. Gentle and quiet spirit. What about gentle? Well, you need to know that the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 10 says, I was gentle among you. He, the apostle, the man who faced persecution and was near death multiple times, who was whipped and beaten and stood up with profound courage, said to the Christians in Corinth, I was gentle when I was with you. Galatians chapter 5, Scripture tells us that this is one of the fruits of the Spirit, right? hey man, I ain't got gentle. I don't do gentle. Hey, good news, join the club. It's the Spirit of God who does gentle. And he creates it. Jesus himself commends the gentle. In fact, he promises an eternal reward. Matthew 5, the Beatitudes. Blessed are, some translations say, the meek. But the word is the exact same Greek word we have here. Blessed are the gentle. And then he goes even further in Matthew chapter 11, the Lord Jesus does. And he gives himself as the consummate example. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, because I am what? Meek, or same word, gentle. Same Greek word here. I am gentle and quiet of heart. You want to know what a gentle and quiet spirit looks like? Answer, you look at the Lord Jesus Christ, who never sinned, who turned over tables in the temple and gave some people what for on a few occasions, who stood toe-to-toe with the Pharisees, who went to his death, who overthrew the devil and hell for our sake. And he says, let me show you what gentle and quiet looks like. You come to me because that's what I am. You're starting to get the taste of what the wife's enduring beauty is in the sight of God now. After some of these, what a great encouragement, what a high honor and a value it is that God himself places upon a wife who chooses to say, okay, I am just going to seek to imitate and enjoy my Savior. I'm going to seek that my beauty come from within, but oh God, I need your help. It's this idea that it's done unto the Lord and the Lord knows it that closes out verse 4. The imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. First, you need to know that this is an imperishable quality. Same word that's used in chapter 1, speaking of our inheritance reserved in heaven that is imperishable and cannot fade away. For every follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, a gift, because he has saved you and now you are his. Because you confessed your sin, you've turned, and you've been made his child. He says, there is an imperishable gift. Same word. There's an imperishable gift in the heart of every woman of God who chooses to adorn herself this way, and it does not fade. Sounds a little bit, right? Like Proverbs 31, charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. It doesn't fade. And then at the end of 4, he says, this is precious in the sight of God. I want you to see first, and I probably wasn't clear, first I want you to see that this that Peter exhorts is to beauty that is internal, not external. That's what we just covered. Beauty is internal, not external. Second, I want you to see the surpassing value of this beauty. The surpassing value. We just saw how it's imperishable, but now we see that it's precious in the sight of God. You know what I'm trying? I'm trying to hold my tongue when I know I'm just going to tear him down and I'm going to emasculate him and I'm going to start another fight and I'm going to destroy him. And I could do it. I could do it because I'm sharper with my tongue than he is and I could win, but I know I don't want to win. So I'm trying, but you know what? He doesn't notice. Guess what the Lord does? This is a beauty even when your husband doesn't notice that is precious in the sight of God. He knows and he sees. And he rewards. That's the encouragement of this passage. It's an enduring beauty, and the Lord is the one who fortifies you for it, and in his time does his work to reward you, whether here or in eternity. I apologize, women, on behalf of all male mankind, that we are so dull. But sometimes when your words won't get through, the Lord alone can. And he does it through your quietness, and he speaks as with a megaphone to get our attention. Praise be to the God who does that, and praise to the Lord who is your hope. Now the passage closes with a couple of examples, so that's what I'm going to do. I want to define these for you and then just give you a couple of examples. This is where he's going to go in 5 and 6. For in this way, in former times, the holy women also who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, being submissive to their own husbands. You can jot this down now. He gives the example of the adornment of hopeful, holy women. So wife, this is your profound encouragement. And husband, If it's not your desire for your wife to be this, maybe starting today, this should be your desire, that she would know the adornment of a hopeful, holy woman. Because those are exactly Peter's words in verse 5. They hoped in God, and they were the holy women, verse 5. And he's going to give a second example, and if you want, you can jot this down. It is to be, sorry, this one isn't as clean, a worker of good and a fearless woman, because that's what Peter gives next. A worker of good and a fearless woman. 6, just as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you have become her children, if you do what is right, that's the word good, a worker of good, if you do good without being frightened by any fear. Fearless, these women are. So first, there are some examples that we are told to consider, to think of. The hopeful, holy women of God, the women of old, who showed us this very thing that Peter talks about. Wife, who are some of these women for you? Do you have some in your life that you know of? Young women, find other hopeful, holy women and learn from them. Say, there is a woman, I want to be just like her when I grow up. She's my hero. I love the way she is with her husband and with her children, and I just love the way she is, you know, out of the house and with people in public and with me. I want to be just like that. Find other hopeful, holy women and learn from them. And all of you women of God, learn about the hopeful, holy women who went before us and who glorified God in their own lives. Let me tell you a little bit about Sarah Pierpont. Sarah Pierpont was a peculiar girl. In fact, even her own mother would agree when she was told that her daughter was peculiar. She said, yeah, definitely she is. Irene Howitt relates the story of how Sarah's mother would say even more about her. Her mother would say, even when she was a little child toddling around our feet, she seemed to somehow just have a sense that the Lord was with her. When Jonathan Edwards met Sarah Pierpont afterwards, he wrote, "She is of a wonderful sweetness, calmness, and universal benevolence of mind." I know we don't say that in the 21st century, but that was really cool if you were a girl about 3 centuries ago. "She will sometimes go about from place to place singing sweetly and seems always to be full of joy and pleasure, and no one knows for what. She loves to be alone, walking in the fields and groves, and seems to have someone invisible always conversing with her." No, Sarah Pierpont didn't have a special invisible friend. Sarah Pierpont had a friend whom she talked to all the time, the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you haven't figured out by now, Jonathan Edwards, a number of years later, would marry Sarah Pierpont. And she would become Sarah Edwards. And it was not an easy situation circumstantially for Jonathan Edwards or for Sarah. He moved from a number of different posts. He was a pastor and a missionary. And if you want to know anything about him, then the simplest way to get from here to there is the words, "The Great Awakening." Jonathan and Sarah Edwards were used mightily in history to see thousands upon thousands come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm not just talking about some happy revival where everybody had an emotional experience and 48 hours later the hangover wore off and they woke up and they went back to their broken lives. If you read the histories of the Great Awakening, you'll find that there were actual towns that in some places were so renowned for their drunkenness and their revelry that nobody went out of their doors or even went into the town or the village after dark unless you were going out to get drunk. Because if you did, you would be beaten, you'd be robbed, you'd be raped, or you'd be killed. After the Great Awakening, you know what happened? Some of these very towns were so utterly transformed from the inside out that the police didn't know what to do with themselves. Like, they sat around twiddling their thumbs because there wasn't anybody to arrest anymore. Like, what do we do with ourselves? Everybody just loves Jesus, and the bars literally closed down in some places. Jonathan Edwards was the guy who actually wrote the book about how do you know if a revival is really a revival. He wrote this book in the 1700s that was all about, hey, man, you can go and get people whipped up and excited, but come back 2 weeks later and there's nothing. He says, I've seen that. But I've seen the real thing. Let me tell you what the real thing looks like. And he wrote a book about it that we still read today. It's actually fabulous. So the point of all of this is to just say you can imagine the spiritual battle that Jonathan and Sarah Edwards live their lives in the midst of. Sarah Edwards was a godly and a faithful woman in so many ways. I don't commend to you their marriage as a perfect example, because there were some peculiarities about it, and it was exceedingly difficult. But I do commend it to you, what little I have read about it and what little I know of it, as an incredibly faithful marriage through some incredibly difficult situations. They had a daughter, her name was Esther. Esther Edwards grew up, and she fell in love with a guy you may have heard of. His name was Aaron Burr, of Hamilton fame. Aaron Burr and Esther Edwards got married in 1752. At the wedding, someone came to Esther and said, "Well, you know, your father is a remarkable man." And she agreed. She said, he truly is. You have no idea. But she didn't stop there, too. She said, "Also, my mother is a most remarkable woman." And the person said to her, "In what way?" Esther said, "God gave mother the gift. God gave mother the gift of accepting what happens without grumbling, knowing that the Lord always does what is good, even when we can't see what good will come out of it." That was Esther as a grown married woman giving testimony of her own mom in the home. The wife's enduring beauty in the sight of God is the same as that adornment of the hopeful, holy women of old. Find those women, learn from them. Peter goes on now to speak of those workers of good and fearless women. If we had the time, we could talk about this word good. I keep mentioning it to you because I just want you to see it somewhere along the line. I don't know when. We're going to camp on this word. But it's the word right. If you do what is right without being frightened by any fear. Same Greek word as for good. One of Peter's themes throughout the book is that in the midst of a broken world, in the midst of an unbelieving world, believers have a hopeful, holy witness in their homes and outside, and they just continue to go about the job of doing good. Okay, so it's here. Boom, there it is. Big light so you can see it. But he doesn't comment on it, but he carries the theme. But not only workers of good, there is a fearlessness, that marks these women, Peter says. Men, I know that this is not spoken to you, but this is a good place of any to draw us into the bigger context and make sure that we don't go home feeling like we got forgotten this morning. So you don't have to go home empty-handed. Men, if you take nothing else away from this point of the passage, my encouragement to me and to you is, men, that you relieve the fears of your wife. If you want to have a wife who's fearless, then make it your job to relieve her fears. And to lead her like Christ would lead the church. If you do that, you have a much better chance of having a wife who's fearless, right? That's our call. If a woman has to fear her husband, then there is something terribly wrong there. And the abuse of authority is not taken lightly by the Lord. In fact, the abuse of spiritual authority is of peculiar offense to the Lord Jesus Christ. And we'll get to some of that later on. But just note that these are women who do not need to live in fear. God himself will take to account any man who abuses his authority in the home or with his children or anywhere else. God will take to account. And so also should the governing authorities, and so also will the church if necessary. Enough said. Here what we have is an encouragement by Peter to be daughters of Sarah, to live fearless lives, to live lives that are actually capable of doing good, even though the world may not understand, to love and submit because the Lord is the one who looks on. Let me close with this story of Aisha. John Piper relates this. I'll tell you up front, this is not a scenario of a wife, but it is a scenario of a woman's fearlessness that I think, as you'll see, is fitting with this passage. Aisha is a 24-year-old Christian widow. A 24-year-old Christian widow. Understand all that? And a convert from Islam. She was so outgoing in her witness to Christ in the hostile environment of her Islamic town that the authorities arrested her and put her in the dark, unfinished cellar of the police station until she'd come to her senses. She was there for quite some time. At the point when she felt like she couldn't take it anymore and was about to scream, instead, to her surprise, as she opened her mouth, what came out was a song of praise to the Lord. Now, as she was beneath the office of the police station, she could hear the officers upstairs moving around. And as she began to sing, to her surprise, the movement upstairs ceased. They were listening. A little later that night, the police chief came down. And he told Aisha he was taking her home, but only on one condition. You must come to my house in 3 days. And then he said this. I don't understand. You're not afraid of anything. My wife and daughters and all the women in my family are afraid of everything. But you're not afraid of anything. I want you to come to my house so that you can tell everyone why you are not afraid. And then I want you to sing that song. John Piper says, when I read that, I thought surely that's exactly the kind of thing the Apostle Peter had in mind when he wrote these words in 1 Peter 3. And you are her children if you do good, and you do not fear any frightfulness. It is an enduring beauty that is precious to the Lord, and it is unto him who sees and who rewards, who protects and who carries. And sometimes, just sometimes, it is through a woman that God will get a man's attention among so many other things that he does, because he does it to his glory. Stand with me. Let's close together in prayer. Gracious God, our Father, I thank you this morning that you who knit together every single human being and every single woman, that you know every wife here today and everyone following along online and everyone who will listen in. And for some, the word submit is so impossible because they have been so deeply wounded. I thank you that you are a God who knows and cares, that you are the Lord who comforts and who fights and who defends. Lord, I pray if there be any marriage, if there be any home here within our body or even related to it, where there is any kind of abuse of authority, O Lord, our God, I pray you would expose it. And if necessary, Lord, you would judge it. I pray that couples would come, if necessary, either to our body or to their friends and say, would you help us? We are so messed up. Would you pray with us? Would you help us get help? If there is such a thing, then Lord God, let it be revealed so that you, bringing it into the light, can heal and make whole. Lord, all of that we'll ask for your help with, and we'll put it in your hands. Beyond this, our Father, we thank you for the sweet and rich truth that to submit to you in how we live out our lives in all relationships is one that is second to none. And Lord, you make us thirsty for it. So grant us the grace to imitate Christ, to honor Christ, and to enjoy Christ even more this week in every place you put us. We'll ask it all for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thanks for being here with us to worship this morning. You guys have a great week.
Tremble, did you hear the oceans roar?